Hello, welcome back. And this week we're going to continue our exploration of various kinds of logical fallacies. We've already discussed the basic notion of a fallacy, so let's just jump into our examples. First, let's consider the fallacy of hasty generalization. Hopefully this one should be pretty intuitive. We've all probably been guilty of this kind of reasoning at some point in the past. A hasty generalization is simply when you form a general conclusion about some group or class, but you do so on the basis of just a few examples. So, for instance, Alice is an adult and she's tall. Bob is an adult and he's also tall. So, I guess all adults are tall. Now, obviously, one can't form a conclusion about all adults on the basis of just two examples. That would be what we might call jumping to a conclusion. And we looked at examples like this when discussing inductive strength and weakness. So recall that an inductively strong argument is one in which the premises make the conclusion very likely to be true. So if the premises are true, then the conclusion is probably true as well. Whereas a weak argument is one in which even if the premises are true, that still wouldn't mean that the conclusion was all that likely. So clearly this is an example of weak rather than strong inductive reasoning. Even if Alice and Bob are tall, that doesn't make it very probable that all adults are tall, since there are billions of adults. So this is a hasty generalization, or a kind of jumping to a conclusion. It's clearly a fallacy because it's a poor way to reason. A good inductive argument should appeal to a strong body of evidence to support the conclusion. But if you form a hasty generalization, then you're likely to be wrong much of the time. So it's definitely something to avoid. Next, let's consider another intuitive type of fallacy, weak analogy. An argument exhibits a weak analogy when it tries to appeal to an analogy or similarity between two domains, say X and Y, but in fact X and Y aren't really all that similar, or the analogy is a really poor one. So just for example, you shouldn't go to the concert. Going to a concert is like climbing a mountain. It's dangerous and cold. Well, this strikes me as a pretty strange argument. Is going to a concert really like climbing a mountain? Well, maybe it's true that some concerts are dangerous, and maybe even cold, but otherwise it doesn't really seem like a very intuitive or powerful metaphor for going to a concert. Now, I mean, analogical thinking in terms of analogies, is a very powerful and important cognitive tool. So it's definitely appropriate to do so in certain circumstances. But hopefully the analogy is a good one, one that really sheds light on the two things that are being compared. If you rely on a weak analogy, then it doesn't really make sense to draw any inferences about one thing on the basis of the other, since they're not all that similar in the first place. Okay, next let's talk about a kind of argument that comes up a lot in philosophical debates. It can be a little hard to grasp, but hopefully you'll catch on to the idea. It's known as begging the question, and it refers to an argument which contains a premise that already assumes that the conclusion is true, or where the conclusion is kind of just a restatement of the premises. So for example, consider this argument. Carol is lying about her grade. I know, she is because she's not telling the truth. Now, suppose you were trying to convince someone that Carol is lying about her grade. Normally, we assume that an argument is directed towards someone who doesn't already agree with your conclusion. So, let's suppose you're trying to argue that Carol is lying about her grade, and you're arguing with someone who thinks that she's not lying. Would they find this argument convincing at all? Problem is, if you don't already believe that Carol is lying about her grade, then you're not going to believe that she's not telling the truth. Right? The premise and the conclusion basically state the same thing. So obviously that doesn't make for a very persuasive argument. A good argument is supposed to persuade someone who doesn't already accept the conclusion, and it's supposed to do so by using premises that the other person will accept and agree with. But if an argument begs the question, then it won't be very persuasive. If the premise and the conclusion are basically saying the same thing, then the other person won't be inclined to accept the premises unless they already accept the conclusion. So basically, it's not likely to convince anyone. It's worth mentioning, perhaps, that some people use the phrase begging the question to really mean raising the question. So for instance, someone might say, we will soon be able to make trips to nearby planets. This begs the question, is space travel safe? This doesn't really beg the question, at least in the philosophical sense. Rather, the sentence might raise the question of whether space travel is safe, but it doesn't beg the question. In other words, it doesn't really assume as a premise in an argument that space travel is safe. So it's worth clarifying that begging and raising the question are two different things. Okay, next let's look at another kind of fallacy that's fairly widespread. It's called equivocation. Equivocation is when an argument uses an ambiguous word in two different ways, but it ignores the ambiguity and acts as though the word has just one meaning. So, for instance, Justin Bieber is a star. Stars are giant astronomical objects. Therefore, Justin Bieber is a giant astronomical object. Now, hopefully the failure of reasoning in this argument should be pretty clear to you. When the person says Justin Bieber is a star, then clearly they mean that Bieber is a famous celebrity, which is true. But when they say stars are giant astronomical objects, then they're using a different meaning of star. So it's true that stars, in the astronomical sense, are giant astronomical objects. And it's true in the celebrity sense that Justin Bieber is a star. But you can't connect those two statements on the basis of the word star, since it has a different meaning in the two sentences. So equivocation is when an argument ignores the fact that a certain word is ambiguous, and so draws faulty inferences on the basis of the assumption that it has just a single meaning. All right, so next let's consider appeal to majority. An argument involves appeal to majority when it tries to argue that something is true on the basis of the fact that most people believe that it's true. For instance, let's go back to a time when people believed that the Earth was the center of the universe and the sun and stars revolved around the Earth. Right, then this guy Galileo gets up and says that the Earth actually revolves around the sun, and someone responds by saying, you know, in Italian or whatever, the sun revolves around the Earth. Come on, everyone knows that. This is a fallacy because the fact that some people believe, or that some belief is commonly held, doesn't necessarily make it true. People can be wrong about all sorts of things, and sometimes lots of people can be wrong at the same time, just like the belief that the sun revolves around the Earth. So you can't prove a point just by saying that other people agree with you. That's not going to be very convincing to someone who disagrees with you. And it's certainly not a valid form of reasoning, since human history contains all sorts of cases where basically everyone was wrong about a given question. Okay, so let's continue looking at some more fallacies in the next section of the video.